This video will cover weighted average process costing. The beginning inventory in units in the work in process department, plus the units the company started on during the period, give us units to be accounted for. These are the amounts going in. We know that what goes in must come out. At the end of the period, these units will be in two locations. They either will be an ending inventory in the work in process account, units that are not complete, or units that are 100% complete and have been transferred out. Technically, there's a third category of units, those that are accumulated as spoilage or damaged units. If you take the controllership course or cost accounting 2, you will look at how do you handle the cost of spoiled units. We're going to look at the production cost report for weighted average process costing. There are a number of sections. We begin with the physical units section, which will be occupying the space in the upper left corner. I have listed some problem data here. This comes from handout 3B, the Harden widgets problem. This company has 4 departments. We will be doing the production cost report for the cutting department, the first of the 4 departments. What happens in this department, a company begins the production process. The shaping department takes units that were produced in cutting and adds more materials and conversion cost, and once shaping is finished with those, it transfers them out to the next department, and then assembly, the next department transfers them out to packaging, and finally to finished goods. A company has 4 work in process accounts if it has 4 departments or 4 processes that its inventory items must pass through. So let's begin with the physical units. Physical units are those units that we don't worry about, are they complete or are they just partially complete. At the beginning of the period, February 28th, which is also March 1st, we have 75,000 units. These units obviously are partially complete. They are left over from the previous period. During the period, the company started 300,000 additional units. When we add the 300,000 units to the beginning units, this company has 375,000 units in total they must account for. We need to know where these units will be at the end of the period. If there are 375,000 units that go in, 375,000 units must come out. Our totals for these 2 physical unit sections must equal. This problem tells us the work in process at the end of March contained 80,000 units. The problem doesn't tell us how many units were completed and transferred out, but since we know we have to have 375,000 units here, we can work backwards and determine that there must be 295,000 units that were completed and transferred out. Next, we will work on the equivalent units of production section. We categorize units for direct materials and separately for conversion cost. Recall that conversion cost consists of direct labor and manufacturing overhead. We consider these cost to be the work effort, how much effort was putting into completing units during the period. The equivalent units of production, or equivalent units, represents if we had started and completed from 0 to 100% only full units, that this is how many units we could have produced. Obviously, most companies don't make that effort. They aren't worried about partial units at the end of the period or partial completion of units. We'll begin with the completed and transferred out row, and I'm going to mark it here There are two columns listed under direct materials. One is for us to note the percentage complete. Units that we completed during the period better be 100% complete, or we should not have transferred them out. They should be complete 100% for direct materials and complete 100% for conversion cost. If we multiply the percent complete times the units, the physical units, that will tell us the equivalent units of work effort in terms of materials and separately for conversion cost. So 100% times 295,000 for each of these. At the end of the period, we had 80,000 units. If they were 100% complete, we would have transferred them out. So obviously, they are not complete. Our data tells us that as it relates to conversion cost in ending work in process, these units are 55% complete. We place our 55% here under the conversion cost percentage column. If we take the 80,000 physical units and multiply it by the 55% complete, that gives us 44,000 equivalent units in ending inventory. In other words, if we had put forth all our effort in these 80,000 units and only starting and completing them, leaving none of them partially complete, we could have finished 44,000 of them. We also need to track this for direct materials. The percentage for direct materials often differs from the percentage of conversion cost because of the timing of when materials are added compared to the timing of when work effort is actually performed. Our problem tells us that direct materials that have been added are equivalent to 90% for the ending inventory units. We place that 90% in the direct materials column. In determining the equivalent units, we multiply the 90% times the 80,000 physical units, and this tells us if we had used our direct materials only for starting and completing units, the materials we used could have completed 72,000 full units. We need to now add the ending units and those transferred out. For direct materials, we have 367,000 equivalent units, and for conversion cost, we have 339,000 equivalent units. Our next section is called the cost to be accounted for. We have a number of costs provided in the data. The beginning inventory cost in direct materials, it goes right here in this cell, consists of the actual cost of direct materials in beginning inventory. During the period, we added extra cost during March for materials. Direct materials cost added during March totals $423,000. We now add these two costs together, and this gives us the cost to be accounted for solely for materials. We need to do the same thing for conversion cost. At the beginning of the period, conversion cost accumulated, actual conversion cost in beginning work in process was $54,250. The conversion costs that were added during the period, during March, total $547,000. Adding these two amounts together, we obtain cost to be accounted for conversion cost. Adding both of these together gives us a very important amount that we'll need for reconciliation purposes. This is called the cost to be accounted for. You can see that I have highlighted it in light blue because it's a very important label that must appear in the production cost report. Next, we look at the cost per unit. The cost per unit is determined by taking the total cost to be accounted for and dividing it by the equivalent units of production. Our equivalent units of production are here in columns J and L on row number 10. So let's begin with the cost to be accounted for materials are $526,000. For direct materials, we had 367,000 equivalent units. Dividing these two amounts, this gives us a cost per unit for materials of about $1.43. It's very important to not round. It's helpful to always keep at least 5 decimal places when you start determining which cost will be transferred out and which will remain in ending inventory. We do the same type of calculation for conversion cost. We begin with the cost to be accounted for. We divide it by the units accounted for, and that gives us about $1.77. Again, this amount we should retain at least 5 decimal places. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to reconcile. Now we're going to move down to the cost accounted for section and determine what the cost transferred out is. I am going to hide a couple of rows here because we're going to run out of space if we continue the report. So let's hide these three. And now we only have the display of the equivalent units, which we need, and our cost per unit, and the cost to be accounted for. So we begin with transferred out. In the direct materials column, we see that 295,000 units were completed and transferred out. So our 295,000 units is assigned, each of these units is assigned a cost of 1.43324, or about $1.43. This gives us a cost to be assigned to units that will be transferred out of work in process, the 295,000, or 422,807. At this point, it's fine to go ahead and round to the nearest whole dollar. In conversion cost, we also had 295,000 units transferred out. However, our cost is now about $1.77.360. So we retain 5 digits, and that will help us reconcile more accurately at the end of the period. So our 295,000 units transferred out times our cost per unit gives us $523,212. Adding these two amounts together, this tells us that during the period, the company completed and transferred out 295,000 units with a total cost of $946,018. Now we'll determine the cost of the ending inventory that remains in the work in process account for the cutting department. We see up here in the equivalent units section that we have 72,000 equivalent units as it relates to material. So 72,000 times the about $1.43 cost, and that will give us the ending inventory direct materials cost, 72,000 times about $1.43. This company has $103,193 in ending work in process for just materials. We see that there are 44,000 equivalent units of conversion cost in ending inventory. So the cost we assign to each of those units is about $1.77. Again, take care not to round to less than 4 decimal places. Multiplying the 44,000 times the $1.77 and some change units, we end up with $78,038. Adding these two amounts together, we know that our ending inventory should be $181,233. Now to reconcile. To reconcile, we need to know that the cost to be accounted for equal the total cost accounted for. The cost we just accounted for are those transferred out and those in ending inventory. So if we add these two amounts together, we hope that the total cost accounted for equal the cost to be accounted for. And indeed they do. Now we look at our T account for the work in process to see how these costs flow through. I'm going to name this T account work in process cutting. Recall that we have a separate work in process T account for each process. And this is the cutting process. Processes are often referred to as departments. Our beginning inventory, even though here we see it in two components, will always be the result of multiple costs together. Beginning inventory is an amount that we carry forward from previous periods. And that amount is always netted together. We don't carry it forward as two separate amounts. So the beginning inventory for materials plus the beginning inventory of conversion cost are the balance in work in process cutting at the beginning of the period. During the period, we added some direct materials cost, and that amount was $423,000. We also added conversion cost of $547,000. We just determined that the cost we will be transferring out is $946,018, and that amount is a credit. It reduces the cost in the work in process account. This is comparable to cost of goods manufactured. And for this particular department, this is the cost of goods manufactured for this department. Our ending balance, if we add our debits and then subtract the cost transferred out, we get what we hope is the same ending balance, which is which amounts to $181,232. And if we look at the costs that we've assigned to ending inventory, our T account is in balance, and our production cost report is in balance as well. This concludes weighted average process costing with no transferred in cost.